brought to you by DK Audio.
DK Audio presents DK Life Stories, Jesse Owens, by James Buckley Jr. Read by Vaughn, Joseph. Dear listener, the story of American Olympic hero Jesse Owens is covered in gold for the four medals he won in 1936. It's also covered with racism, which he battled with throughout his life. Jesse grew up in the segregated South, but fought his way out using speed and courage. After defeating the insane ideas of Nazism, he returned to a United States that remained divided by race, even as it united in celebrating his victories. Jesse's story mirrors the struggle of African Americans in the 20th century. It also tells the tale of how some star athletes struggled to reach the same heights away from their sports as they achieved in them. Jesse was one of the fastest people of all time, but he could not outrun all the troubles in his life. But Jesse's is also a comeback story. After reaching the heights of fame and then falling, he climbed back to a place of love and respect. And that might have been the greatest victory of all. Now let's go back to a time when the world needed a hero. On your marks, get set, listen. Happy listening, James Buckley Jr. Chapter 1, A Slow Start. Jesse Owens was born into extreme poverty in Oakville, Alabama, USA in 1913. As soon as he could, Jesse started a lifelong race to escape it. Jesse was born James Cleveland Owens about 50 years after slavery officially ended in the United States. However, life for African Americans was still very difficult, especially in the southern states. Jesse's parents, Henry and Emma Owens, were the children of people who had been enslaved. The end of the Civil War and the Emancipation Proclamation had set enslaved people free. However, being free and being safe and successful were different things. What is the Emancipation Proclamation? This was a document written in 1863 by President Abraham Lincoln that officially freed all people who were enslaved in the southern United States. Henry and Emma married in 1895. Henry worked as a sharecropper in the town of Oakville, Alabama. He worked long hours in the fields for very little money. Together, they had 12 children, though three sadly died at birth. Of those surviving children, the three oldest were daughters, and the next six were sons. This large family lived in a small wooden house with just three rooms. When they were old enough, the children often joined Henry picking crops and tending the fields. The younger kids attended school in a one-room schoolhouse, when there was a teacher available, that is. Sharecropping. This was a type of farming often found in the South in the years after the Civil War, 1861 to 1865, which was fought between the Southern slave-owning states and the Northern states. African Americans who wanted to earn money farming generally could not afford to buy their own land, so they rented it, usually from white landowners. The farmers had to pay the rent with a share of the crops they grew. Unfortunately, the system worked in favor of the landowners. They gave the farmers seeds and gear in return for more crops. However, if the crops failed, the farmers fell into debt and often never earned a profit on their work. Some called it slavery by another name. Throughout the southern United States, tens of thousands of African Americans worked and lived like this. The white governments of those states passed Jim Crow laws that created a two-part way of life. For example, black people could not go to theaters with white people or share most public toilets or pools. African American children were educated at separate schools. In some places, there were even separate drinking fountains. What were the Jim Crow laws? Rules that created separate public places for white people and black people. In 1913, while living this hard life, the Owens family got what Emma called a gift child. James Cleveland, Jesse, her seventh son, was born on the 12th of September of that year. Everyone called him J.C. Early in his life, J.C. struggled. One of the problems of living in poverty is that it is hard to get the right nutrients you need to stay healthy. Meat was a treat in the Owens house, typically only served on public holidays. Beans were the usual family meal, along with a few vegetables from their farm. Plus, the house had no heating and no electricity. JC was a small baby and a small child. As a result of the family's poor living conditions, he was often very ill. He had fevers. He caught bad colds. Several times he had painful boils. Emma had to carve them out with a hot knife before they got infected. Despite this, JC had fond memories of his hard young life. "We used to have a lot of fun," he said later. "We always ate. The fact that we didn't have steak? Who had steak?" Not all of his memories were good ones, though. He told an interviewer once that there was often no money to buy clothing. "I sometimes didn't have enough to cover myself." Jesse remembered one time that he had been embarrassed by being seen by girls when he was wearing barely any clothes. But young JC got stronger as he grew up. He loved playing games with the many children in his neighborhood. Most were the sons and daughters of sharecroppers. They all lived in poverty, but this did not stop them enjoying themselves and having fun. Did you know Jesse's family regularly attended the Oakville Baptist Church near their home? Even at this early age, games that included lots of running were JC's favorites. Life remained hard, however. Then, in 1915, it got harder still, thanks to an insect. The boll weevil arrived in the South and destroyed millions of dollars worth of crops, mostly cotton. Many farms failed and thousands of people lost jobs and money. Amid all this, people like the Owens family looked for a way out. One of JC's sisters, Lily, moved north to the big city of Cleveland, Ohio, looking for work. She was so thrilled with what she found there that she encouraged her parents to join her. Lily's father, Henry, went first with two of her brothers. He soon had a well-paid job, and he wrote to Emma back at the tiny wooden house. Soon, the whole Owens family was on the move to a better life. "I always loved running. I wasn't very good at it, but I loved it because it was something you could do all by yourself. You could go in any direction, fast or slow as you wanted." Jesse Owens, in his book, Jesse, A Spiritual Autobiography, 1978. Chapter 2. Picking Up Speed. In about 1922, no one is sure of the exact year, JC's mother, Emma, got word from his father up in Cleveland. Emma sold everything the family owned for only $24. That's the same as about $800 today. After a long train ride, the family were together again, this time in a house with room enough for all. The Owens family were not alone in moving north. Throughout the 1920s and 1930s, several million African Americans moved from the South to large cities in the North. They moved from farms to find jobs in factories. This movement came to be called the Great Migration. The Great Migration. In the years after World War I, 1914 to 1918, almost 2 million African Americans moved from farms in the South to cities in the North in search of a better life. By the time of World War II, 1939 to 1945, northern cities such as Chicago, Cleveland, Detroit, and New York had large African American populations. The African American families still faced discrimination or unjust treatment due to the color of their skin, but it was usually not as bad as their experiences in the South. Most earned enough money to rent good apartments or houses. Others were able to start their own businesses. In their new hometown, JC and his siblings went straight to work part-time. JC worked at a shoe shop, polishing boots and sweeping floors. And for the first time in their lives, the Owens children went to a normal school with different year groups and classrooms. At Bolton Elementary in Cleveland, JC got a new nickname. JC's teacher did not understand his Southern accent and thought he said his name was Jesse. The young boy was too shy to correct her, so he became Jesse Owens for the rest of his life. Along with a new name, Jesse had a new experience, going to school with white children. Most of the kids in the Owens family's neighborhood had also come from other places. The white pupils were the children of parents who had come from Southern and Eastern Europe. Jesse found that he could make friends easily with kids from all over. After Bolton, Jesse went to Fairmount Junior High, starting in seventh grade. He was 14 years old. There he met a girl called Ruth Solomon. They soon became close and started dating. Jesse spent his break times racing around the playground, showing off his favorite thing, running. He was watched by a man named Charles Riley, a teacher at the school and the track coach. Riley saw something special in how Jesse ran. He encouraged Jesse to become more serious about racing and join the school's track team. Very quickly, Riley was proved right. Jesse really was something special. When he was in eighth grade, he ran 100 yards in 11.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.